Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit. Bandwidth for the new screensavers is provided by CashFly at CacheFly.com.
Hi, this is Leo Laporte, and once again, time for Twit's audience survey. We'd really like to hear from you. It's only going to take a couple of minutes, really. That's all. Just go to twit.tv/survey and let us know what you think. Your anonymous feedback will help us make Twit even better. And thanks for your continued support.
The new Screensavers is brought to you by Curry, a real live robot with a great personality. Curry is available for pre-order now at heycurry.com. That's HeyKurri.com. And by Blue Apron, the number one fresh ingredient and recipe delivery service in the country. See what's on the menu this week and get three meals free with your first purchase with free shipping by going to blueapron.com/NSS. And by Rocket Mortgage from Quicken Loans. When it comes to the big decision of choosing a mortgage lender, work with one that has your best interest in mind. Use Rocket Mortgage for a transparent, trustworthy home loan process that's completely online at quickenloans.com/NSS.
Beating window scammers at their own game, an oven that thinks like a chef, and a Samsung's Chromebook Plus a home run? Live from Twit Eastside Studios in beautiful Petaluma, it's the new Screensavers.
That was Nate?
That was Nate from Los Angeles.
That was a one-take Nate right there.
One-take Nate, we call him.
Not even two takes.
He's got his own moniker. He's here with the Jolly Roger Telephone Company. We'll talk about that in a little bit. Hello, Alex Wilhelm.
How are you?
I'm great.
That's fantastic.
You've got a corgi on your chest.
I do. You have a fake police badge on yours. I can't decide which one makes less sense, but you go first. What is the Chicopee police?
I just had this lying around in my closet. I thought I'd put it on. I think it goes back to a calendar shoot I did.
Is that from like a Halloween costume or kind of an adult
Halloween
shoot. Costume?
It was a calendar shoot.
Okay,
we did a different costume for every month. But I don't have the hat. So this, one of these things is not like the other. This is a, I think it's an actual Chicopee police uniform.
It's a little,
I don't know.
It's got holes in it though. It's not in
it's
great
not
shape.
Perfect. And okay. You know, frankly, I look like Marge in Fargo. But the hat is from Moscow. This is a Moscow police officer's.
Those aren't in vogue right now in Washington or kind of across the U.S.
I know. Yeah. Hello, comrade. Hello.
No, they already have it bugged. Don't worry. Don't shout.
Shout.
Normal
don't
voice.
Need to
inside
shout.
Voice.
We're actually broadcasting this globally, so they. Did you know that? So they probably don't need to record it. Alex is here with a new job. You're at Crunchbase now.
That's I am fantastic. Indeed. That's why I have the corgi on the shirt. So.
Congratulations.
Thank you, sir. It's been 3 weeks.
What are you doing at Crunchbase?
I'm the editor in chief. So we're going to launch a new publication called CrossFit. What was that?
No, I'm just like blown away. You're editor in chief?
Yes, sir.
Congratulations.
Thank you. We're launching
now,
a new
traditionally,
thing.
I always you worked at TechCrunch for a while before
yes, sir.
Your, you know, peregrinations. But Crunchbase, I always thought, was just the thing that appeared at the bottom of TechCrunch articles
yeah.
that told you who had invested and how much. I've used it many times.
Yeah.
But I didn't know it had an editorial arm.
It does now.
So you're going to start doing...
It's been brand new. So
very
we've been building
good.
That kind of from the ground up, and it's
what a
been,
great gig.
Yeah, so far it's been a lot of fun. The food's good. The people are nice.
They have you know? Food?
There's food sometimes, yes.
We're going to have food, too. In fact, a little bit later on, I don't know why, I thought it smelled a little bit like salmon in here, and then I realized
I
that's because
too.
There's salmon...
Literally.
In our June oven. We're going to cook. We're going to give you a little demo of the June smart oven. This is an oven that connects the internet, your smartphone, and cooks... Very well.
I am skeptical of this. I want to see it actually pull this off because I hear that this sort of thing is good on paper and not good on the plate.
My thought exactly until I got it.
All
but
right.
I want to give you a demo right. and a review. I also have a review of the new Chromebook from Samsung. We've been waiting for kind of a mid-range Chromebook. This is all aluminum body, lightweight, good screen. Is it, a good computer, though? That's going to be the question.
That's so my core complaint. Not games, just day-to-day use.
Yeah, for day-to-day use. Could you write your Crunchbase articles on it, for instance? We'll talk about that. I mentioned the Jolly Roger Telephone Company. Roger Anderson, who created it, is here. Thank goodness he brought his family, because that's our entire studio audience. There's a few other people as well. But Roger is doing something, I think, illegal, but we'll find out.
It's kind of like legal plus, I feel. Just a little bit more than
extra legal.
Exactly.
And that's why I'm wearing the outfit. If I have to arrest him, I will.
Does Twit have its own jail? Is that the room back that I've never been into?
It's called the no-hole. Do you know how much of your information is on Facebook? Or what others see of you? Did you know?
I guarantee it's more than I'd like.
Exactly. Yeah. And Megan will show us a new tool that lets you find out. An update. Remember the wonderful assistive arm the dad made for his daughter to help her recover use of her arm? It worked. He didn't have any experience doing it. We're going to get an update from Bono Honan and his daughter, Laura Lai. Jason Howell will help you learn to play guitar, too. But let's, as we always do, start a little bit with the news of the week. Now, you cover news now, right? Other stuff, too? You're covering everything?
Yeah.
Did you follow the PewDiePie controversy?
So I was shocked by this because I feel like I was late to the PewDiePie phenomena all along. And then once he became so popular, then I found out. And then after I found out, he got taken down.
You're not alone. I think anybody under 20 never heard of PewDiePie until he became a phenomenon.
Right.
But he is the number one most followed account.
Like 53 million subscribers on YouTube. It's
on
insane.
YouTube.
I didn't know there were that many monthly active users, but of course it makes sense in retrospect.
His name is his real name is Felix Kjellberg. And he, if you've not seen his videos before, he has a certain style. His style, kids love it.
True.
He started playing video games and swearing, and the kids really loved it.
But that was edgy back then.
It was edgy.
Yeah.
But when the problem with edge is you have to continue to push the envelope.
Mm-hmm.
Most recently, he did a video where he tested out, there he is being scared. He tested, and by the way, the video is gone on YouTube, but he tested out a service called Fiverr.
Fiverr.
Yeah.
Yes, I've seen ads for this on the subway.
Have you ever seen Fiverr? Have you done it?
Is that the thing where you can pay $5 to get somebody to kind of do whatever you want?
Yeah, it's like
kind of
a
demeaning idea. It's not even 1 hour at minimum wage, it's five.
Well, it depends what you ask for. And they can always say no, but if they agree to do it, they get the $5. So he thought, oh, this will be fun. And he offered to pay $5. A couple of Indian guys from India itself. The country.
Mm-hmm. Not the West Indies.
Not the West Indies. The country took him up on it and wrote a horribly anti-Semitic phrase on a sign and held it up.
That was on the video he showed on YouTube.
And he showed the video, explained, I'm paying $5. He showed the video. And as almost always in his videos, reacted with horror or the reaction. There's even a whole series, Scare PewDiePie.
So he just plays videos and then there's video of him and kind of just going,
yeah.
That's a little bit, that's people watch that?
Yeah, 53 million people watch it.
I don't understand humanity, everyone. I'm sorry, but I'm way behind.
Anyway,
on this one.
Of course, this anti-Semitic saying was so appalling. He has a deal with Maker Studios, which is now owned by Disney.
That was a huge deal when that was acquired. It was several hundred million dollars, wasn't it?
And then he had a deal with them to make videos. In fact, that was the Scare PewDiePie videos were professionally shot. And in fact, they even had a season two on the way.
There was season two of Scare PewDiePie.
It was shot and ready to go, but it will not appear because Disney has severed ties over this anti-Semitic incident.
So to be clear, he paid someone to make something to show him, $5, and he showed the horrible...
He says, I just wanted to see if you could do this appalling thing for $5. And he said, you can, I'm shocked,
I'm
appalled.
Did he ask them to do something offensive to show in the video to react to?
Yeah, he thought the Fiverr would say, no, you can't do that, but they did.
So he claims it was a test to see other people's firewalls, but ended up just making very racist comments.
He said, it was a funny meme, and I didn't think it would work. I swear I love Jews, I love them. And then he played a few notes on a kazoo.
He sounds like Donald Trump.
He does it a little. Well, and I think that's part of this, is there's some sensitivity right now.
A little bit.
More so than there should be always to anti-Semitism.
Yes.
So Maker Studio severed their ties with him. So that's could be a lot of money out the window. And then YouTube took him out of their preferred partner program, which allows him to get better quality ads and make more money.
So he got dinged twice on the revenue
front. He got some serious dinging. They didn't kill his account.
Okay.
All right. He's still going to be there. He wrote this in a February post on Tumblr, February 12th post. I was trying to show how crazy the modern world is, specifically some of the services available online. I think of the content that I create as entertainment, not a place for any serious political content. I know my audience understands. That's why they come to my channel. In fact, the audience does understand. The audience has been very aggressively saying to PewDiePie, do not apologize. Do not apologize.
Right. Stand up for your own creative license.
Right. So that's just curious, now that you know the details behind this, I feel like Maker Studio, Disney, even YouTube loved PewDiePie because the kids loved him. They understood that what he was doing was this shocking stuff.
Yeah.
Not anti-Semitic, but they understood that. In fact, he put a post saying a month or two ago saying, I'm leaving YouTube because they don't treat me well because I'm white. He said, there are non-white YouTube people, you know who they are, who are doing better than I am. He said, my views are going down. But again, he says, this was all intended. This is comedy. This is his comedy.
But
he's the Lenny Bruce of the YouTube
era. But you have to actually make a joke for it to be comedy, I feel. Commentary is not
comedy.
That's
because you're old.
I am exactly 6,000 years old, but I mean, I think I should be able to understand this.
That's the Earth, not you.
Oh,
you actually
enough. Much Oh, thank you, Ken Ham. I knew it all along. Young Earth creationism.
Anyway, it's an interesting dilemma because I think Disney, for its brand purposes, and YouTube has to do something.
Oh, they cannot
at the same time,
not do anything.
This is why they embraced PewDiePie in the first
But you
place.
Want to hold him just close enough that you get the uplift from his views, and then not too tight so you can't let him go when he makes a mistake.
Yeah.
But I'm not that surprised that someone that popular made a video eventually multiple years into their career that pushed a line that they thought was still okay.
And here's
my
prediction.
Even though people decide that it wasn't okay.
This ain't the last time.
Oh,
because
no.
What you're seeing is a culture clash between old school mainstream media, of which I have been a part of for decades, and new media. And I'll say it for myself, and I think a lot of people in my business are baffled by YouTube, don't understand 53 million. Where are these people coming from? How do you get a billion views?
Right.
This is crazy. And so we in the old media are going to have some culture clash.
Is there an age minimum for old media status? I'm kind of curious about that.
You're old media. You are old. You're young old. You're one of those young people who's old. Do you know what I'm saying?
I think so. So I go to bed at 8, but I still get up at 8 p.m. No.
You ever had the early bird special at Denny's?
I don't know what that is.
Oh, you ought to go. It's fantastic. Anyway, that's one story.
Speaking
Let's move
of food.
On. Should I start the food?
No. We have a whole thing planned out.
I know, but I feel like if I don't start something now, dinner won't be ready by the end of the show.
Do you want to start the food?
Let me just show you. Give me some bread. This is the June oven. We're going to show you the June oven. I'm going to do a review of this later. But what's cool? One of the things that's cool, and I just want to show you. Give me a couple of slices of bread. One of the things that this has a camera in it, right? So one of the things this will do, I'll just put some bread in, right? Just put it in there, and I'm going to close it, and look. It says it's toast or it's strudel.
Okay, click strudel.
No, because that'll screw it up. I'm going to say toast, and then it'll say, let's get it medium, right? I can do the dial, too. And then toast bread on middle rack. I'm going to toast that bread. And now it's toasting. It tells you the time, but it also on my phone. Now, we're going to show you more later, but the reason I wanted to do that is just to show you that, in fact, you know, it recognized the toast.
Can you put them side by side so we can see the timers go down together?
Yeah. Wow, you're really interested in thrills and chills, aren't you?
There you go.
Look at that.
Yeah, it's off.
Yeah, if this weren't live, could I do that? I don't think so.
There you go.
So anyway, you know what? I don't want to toast bread. So let's stop. How do I stop it? Cancel cooking. I don't really want toast. Here, we don't need that. I'm gonna actually cook some salmon. Did I hit you?
No.
Oh,
no,
I'm
outside the blast radius, I feel.
Okay.
Of the
I want
to explosion.
So we got some salmon, and I want to put because if I don't start this now, it won't be ready by the time that we're going to do the review. So this is a temperature probe. I'm going to put it right in the middle of the salmon. It's very important that you place it right in the middle. Proper probe placement is, as you know, critical. Let's see if it recognizes the salmon. No, it's not bread. And what is sweet?
It's not your personality.
Let me. You know what? This has never happened before. Okay.
Can you reset it?
No, but it has lots of presets. So I'm going to go to see. It has vegetables. So we'll do a salmon fillet, and I'm going to do. I like it a little well done. I notice it doesn't. So let's start that anyway.
Okay.
That way we'll have the. Wait a minute, it's supposed to be on the bottom rack and use the food. Okay, hold on. Hold on.
And this is why people don't usually do live demos.
No, I love this. This is cooking is good. Okay.
Okay.
So, okay, now we're going to start it. Okay, press the checkbox. Okay. Yeah, see, it's going to take, that's going to take a while. So okay. I want to just make sure we have some salmon to try.
So in 16 minutes, you're going to eat salmon on the air.
No, you're going to eat salmon on the air.
Incorrect.
And but it's really good salmon.
I believe you, but not only fish.
And then we'll make the rest of it. We're going to make dinner.
We're making dessert as well, I think.
Yeah, we're going to have dessert and everything. Yeah. So I just wanted to get that started because that's going to take a little while. And you know what's going to happen, of course. Quickly swap in some cooked salmon in there, and I'm gonna just.
There's not enough space to the left for them to pull it
off.
That's cooking.
Look, see, I'm not making that up. It's still cooking. Yeah. By the way, we can watch a video of it cooking. No, I won't do that to you. News item.
Seen, like, 5 videos of that. Today, so.
All right, I got a news item for you.
All right, lay it on there.
Planet of the Apps.
Boo! Wait, I'm sorry. Keep going.
No, that's a reasonable response. Do you know what I'm talking about?
It's the new Apple show they're going to do. It's kind of like Shark Tank, but for apps, and they have some poor celebrities thrown in the mix to give it some credibility, but it's going to be horribly poorly produced and flop after 3 episodes.
I don't know if it's going to be poorly produced, but it's going to be dopey. This is the, don't go to the Recode one. Go to the Recode had a story about it, but there is a trailer that we can watch. So here, I'll get you the trailer. I'll put it
up. It has Will.i.am and Gwyneth Paltrow on it, and it's about tech. It is exactly that good.
Well, and I'm feeling a little sorry for...
Welcome to Planet of the Apes.
Oh, you're not getting my audio.
I can lean next to it.
But we can watch it, because you don't really need the sound. So, it is Will.i.am, Gwyneth Paltrow, Jessica Alba, right, who has her own makeup company, Honest, right?
She's doing pretty well.
Yeah. Will.i.am is just the CEO of Will.i.am. And then Gary Vaynerchuk, okay?
Who we all like.
But the whole trick on this thing is... They're going to give you, you've heard of an elevator pitch?
Yeah, I have.
They're going to give you an escalator pitch.
Is that
so
less
if you've got an app, there
time?
Actually is, see if you can find this on the trailer. The entrepreneurs who are going to show off these apps on this show, and you want to be on the show, right? Because you're going to not only be on the show, which will help you publicize the app,
okay.
But if they pick you, you're going to get one of these famous people helping you out, advising you, you'll get special placement in the App Store. This is like the jackpot. But in order to get this, you have to do the pitch. You work at TechCrunch. You know about the, you know.
I've been in an elevator at a VC office.
Look it.
That had an elevator pitch.
You get on an escalator.
We're going to revolutionize social
media. You have.
Please
are you, that's the timer?
That's the timer.
Oh, that
you're gonna
so
ride
cheesy.
That thing down.
Oh, don't tell me you like that.
No, it's so stupid, I can't believe it.
Thank you. I mean, this makes the Zoom look popular.
They call it the escalator pitch, but it's really a conveyor belt you're riding on.
You know, there was a leader that went down escalator recently to announce his own launch. Trump at his...
Oh, that's right. That's
so
how...
Are they cribbing
you know
from Trump?
I wonder if that's what they got the idea. Anyway, I feel sorry for Gary Vaynerchuk, because I love Gary. He's a good friend of ours. He's completely eclipsed by Gwyneth Paltrow, Jessica Alba, and Will.i.am.
What do Will.i.am do? Are the Black Eyed Peas still a group?
And tech luminaries. It might be.
Because Gary's still relevant in the tech world, and the other two have functioning startups, but I don't know what Will.i.am does.
Is this going to be a hit?
No.
Okay.
Of course not. It looks horrible.
I think Carpool Karaoke, their other show, will.
Well, that's popular already.
Yeah.
This.
Okay, you can cut this.
I'm
so over that.
If you watch the show and do like it, please don't tweet us. Just ever.
It's not over. It's not on yet. That's just a.
That was a future request.
That's a future. Yeah.
I'm not. I mean, do you actually think they have a shot at making enough programming in this show to really drive viewership and change the app economy?
Since you ask, my take. There's two different kinds of people in the world. There's people like you and us. They're geeks.
Mm.
Then there's people who watch reality television. I think it's two different audiences. The people who watch reality television, even Shark Tank, which this is kind of like.
Shark Tank's horrible.
Are not that, well, that's right. That's their reaction to Shark Tank. There would be very interested in the show about apps and developers, the geeks would be, but they don't like this kind of Shark Tankification of the app development.
It feels
process.
Very false.
People who like reality shows will enjoy the reality show aspect, but it's all about these geeks and they're talking about apps.
Oh, so it misses both audiences
it misses
in your
both
view.
Audiences.
Oh, I see. So it's 0-2. Well, if they make a season 2 of this, we'll have to see.
I could be completely wrong. I thought this would be a good show, so.
Well, if on the app show they have the Russian hat with the Chicopee police uniform, I will absolutely tune in.
Pharrell is going to be rocking this look any minute now. I guarantee you.
He may iron the collar, though.
What?
You're getting, it's kind of, it's folded.
I've been hanging out at Dunkin' Donuts.
All right.
You should Did you read Mark Zuckerberg's 6,000-word letter?
I did read it, and I want my time back.
I didn't read it because I looked at it and I thought, I don't think he's saying anything new here. For some reason, the leader of Facebook decided that it was time to rethink Facebook's mission statement. And they took a one-sentence mission statement and turned it into a 6,000-word
post. It was like a novella of mission statement. And he used the word like social infrastructure 12 times or something. It was convoluted and just kind of tough to read.
All I really got out of it is we're going to do like connect the world more, and it's important.
Which they've been doing since they were started. There was one good take, though. Casey Newton, Verge, said they have a new strategy because their old master plan wasn't going to work. Something along those lines. So I feel like people are saying this is a recast of the actual corporate strategy itself, not just that's out for us to read.
Did Casey or you deduce what this new strategy is?
No, but they're going to do something. Snapchat's going to go public. They have to have some sort of response to
it. This is why I didn't read it. I knew you were coming on. I thought you'd explain it to me.
I tried.
That's $22 billion for Snap?
Between 19 and 22, yeah, current pricing.
That's the high end of the low end, somebody said.
It's lower than their last private
The low evaluation. End of the high end.
It's the low end of the high end, sure.
Low end of the high end.
They had $405 million in revenue last year, so their multiple is just enormous.
Okay, wait a
minute. Valuation.
$405 million in revenue. But now remember, revenue is just the money coming in.
Yeah.
What was their profit?
Negative $515 million on a GAAP basis in calendar 2016.
They spent $500 million+.
More than the revenue.
They get $400 million in revenue.
Oh, no, they spent way more than that. Because it's 515 plus 405. Because the loss is after they spent all the revenue.
They spent almost $1 billion.
Yes.
To make $400 million.
If I recall the numbers correctly, yeah.
Well, how could they not do well? That's a great business. Well, if they just kept the money, they'd make more money.
This is what I've been saying. It was a disappointing S1.
They lost.
If those numbers are wrong, I will fact check.
They're in the ballpark.
I wrote them down. Hope that's correct notes. We'll have to see.
This was a very important week if you have a cell phone, and I think everybody watching probably uses a cell phone because Verizon announced a return to unlimited. Remember when
at last?
Yeah, my wife is very happy. She can't wait to get off T-Mobile. We moved her to T-Mobile to save, because she uses a lot of data, and her son uses even more. $80 for single line. That's the same price, roughly, as the other guys.
Yep.
Sprint followed suit. Mm-hmm. AT&T followed suit. Mm-hmm. It's funny, because I remember AT&T CEO saying the dumbest mistake I ever made was offering unlimited data plans.
That was such a great period of time, though. I had that plan on AT&T as an iPhone owner back in the day.
Many people.
It was fantastic.
Are still, holding on because they're grandfathered in. They can't change anything on their plan. Anthony, can't change your plan. Can't do anything. Because you got to keep that grandfather limited data. Anyway, why did this happen?
Because T-Mobile's eating Verizon's lunch.
Really?
Yeah, so last year, if I recall properly, Verizon's mobile revenue went down on a year-over-year basis in every single quarter. And so as T-Mobile just hammers them on features and pricing and so forth, they had no choice but to go back on this. And once Verizon said, okay, unlimited data for some people at some price point, everyone else had to follow the Sprints and so forth. So to me, a long time coming, because I'm paying, don't tell Verizon this, but I'm still on my employee discount, so I get half off. But I would be paying $130 for 10 gigs, which strikes me as too much.
Don't you still work for Verizon?
No, because they spun out Crunchbase.
Oh, that's weird.
Yeah, so that's a convoluted story. I'll spare everyone the corporate stuff.
Okay, so you don't still work for Verizon?
No, but they still don't charge me full price. So thanks, guys. Appreciate it.
I think you're right. I mean, Verizon, is looking at this graph, and this is their profits and revenue. Yeah. They're going down every quarter.
Mm-hmm.
And it's clear that it's the competition, T-Mobile.
Yeah.
This is good for consumers. This is exact proof why it's really important that we have competition, that we have multiple carriers, at least four. We have four plus in the U.S. because that competition forces them to keep prices low, which is why I'm so excited that Sprint and T-Mobile are going to merge.
And by excited, you mean terrified, horrified, and disappointed?
I think this is really disappointing news. Sun, yes. Matsuyoshi Sun of SoftBank, who owns Sprint.
Very, very large bucket of money.
You remember they tried to merge before, and the regulatory, or no, actually AT&T tried to buy, tell me, because you're the financial
guy. Oh my gosh, I forget the details of this. This is hyper
embarrassing. I think they've been trying to merge for decades. That didn't happen because they're number three and number four. Then AT&T was going to buy Sprint, and in both cases, the regulatory climate discouraged any motion. Nothing happened.
The proper, in my view, regulatory climate.
In my view, yes. Proper, because it gave us competition. We see this evidence. But now the feeling is, and Matsuyoshi's son, remember, went and visited with President Trump, mm-hmm. and said, I'm bringing 60,000 jobs to the United States. And my suspicion is, Trump said, go ahead and do that merger.
Just go for it.
Go for the merger.
Who's going to stand up in the current government and say no to that? There's no willpower.
So it looks like what was really working well, I think we have proof positive, this competition, we're going to get one fewer carrier.
Although I will say, we had to expect this for some amount of time. There's no way that we weren't going to get to unlimited data at some point in the future, but I'm glad that it's now. Because I burned through my entire allocation using FaceTime pretty easily.
And so it's not really unlimited. It's
22 gigs.
22
they
gigs,
you,
and then they start to throttle you.
I mean, it's not $15 a gig after your first two.
No,
which is
the
real issue. So thank heavens.
No, it's a good thing.
And about time.
It's a good thing. And by the way, Verizon's getting Lisa back as a customer. She's moving.
Yeah, it's plus one right there.
Yeah. They're slowly working their way back. Digging their way out of the
hole. 6 million more times, and they'll be back to normal.
How's the salmon doing? Oh, it's looking good. That's cooking fast, too. 5 minutes and 40 seconds, it says. It's one of the things that's weird about this oven, though. Sometimes it might jump forward. Let me show you how we know what's going on, though. This is so cool. We can see...
Are you pulling up an app?
Yeah.
Oh, my.
I can see on the app, like, what's lit up. Those are the convection fans. I can see what the current temperature is. And the reason the end time is changing is because we're looking to get to a healthy, safe temperature on the salmon, probably, 145, 150?
Sure.
So that's right now 101. So is it slowly moving up there? Once it gets to 150?
It convects.
It's convecting. It's convecting and cooking at the same time. And
That is two C's.
If it's too far for me to walk over there, I can see how they're doing. There's the picture. That's live. That's a live feed from my oven.
Wow, it's fast-paced.
Wait till you see the time lapse. It's awesome. All right, we're going to take a... Is it time to take a walk? We're going to take a walk. You ready to take a walk?
I'm ready for this.
While the salmon cooks... It smells good in here, doesn't it?
No.
You're not a fish eater.
I'm not a fish eater. This is not my my cup of tea or plate.
I want to walk over and say hi to Roger Anderson. We've had him on before. I'm really thrilled to welcome Jolly Roger back. Hello, Roger. I mean, Jolly. I mean...
Thank you.
Thanks for having me back.
Thanks. Great to see you.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
So last time we talked about the Jolly Roger Phone Company. JollyRogerPhoneCompany.com.
JollyRogerTelephone.com. Telephone.com.
Right.
Okay. Right. Couldn't get Jolly Roger... Naturally.
You were harassing telemarketers by creating robots that would waste their time.
Correct. Calls would come into you. You determine it's a telemarketer. Rather than hang up so they can call somebody else right away, you engage a robot. The robot will chat with them for a while and waste their time.
And we've listened to, I don't know if you remember this, but we listened to the calls. It's hysterical.
Thank you.
This was something you just thought up.
It was completely whimsical. It was only meant to protect my own line at home. And then, and to protect the network, right? Because I love telephones, and I want to protect the telecom network from telemarketing, which I think is bad for the telephone network.
Yeah.
So how long do these response pranks go on? Like, what's an average length of time that you can keep a telemarketer on the line with these canned responses?
I have a lot. I have a lot of calls that are 5 to 10 minutes.
5 to 10 minutes.
5 to 10 minutes with telemarketing.
Do they just give up and be like, "Oh, I'm being played" at some point in time and surrender, or is it?
Most of the time, they think either it's a real person messing with them. Or it's somebody who's just really dumb.
There a difference? They don't get mad, in other words. They don't say, stop messing.
Oh, they get mad.
They get mad.
Yeah, they get mad. The robots don't get mad. Yes, they shout, they swear.
Do we have, it's all on the website, there's tons of them, and you have a call of the day and everything.
There's a bee on me. Hang on. There's a bee on my arm.
So this is the robot.
This is
the robot. It's actually you.
Right.
Okay.
Is it going to sting you?
You know what?
You're okay?
You keep talking. I'm not going to talk, though, but go ahead and keep talking. Say that part again, and I'm just going to.
Say what part again?
Because of this bee.
Because of the bee?
So that's the telemarketer.
It's totally crawling up my arm. It's crawling on my arm.
So you just want to let it crawl, or you can actually flick it before it does anything for you?
Anyway, go ahead. Keep talking.
Yeah, I was. I was saying, you know you can flick it or chew it away and it won't sting you, right?
Sure.
These
crawl on your arm?
Delays are not, they're just
okay,
in there.
Hey.
You're not waiting for him to talk or anything.
It's complicated. It's an algorithm.
So it's responsive.
It is. Yeah.
No, how's this going? Is it going well?
It's going well. I have a lot of traffic, a lot of people interested in using it. I now offer a subscription service for $6 a year. You can sign up and these robots will protect your lines at home. I can intercept the calls.
What's the website again?
JollyRogerTelephone.com.
Okay, there you
go. So if you hate telemarketing, it's a great way to deal with telemarketers.
We got to hurry this up. My Apple Watch tells me the food's going to be ready in 5 minutes.
Oh, gosh. Okay. All right. So
you got a new idea, which sounds to me vaguely illegal, but go ahead. Tell me about this.
Okay. So we're all familiar, especially you and your audience, we're familiar with the Windows pop-up that says your computer is infected by a virus.
Right? Hate those.
Yeah.
And I had a caller the other day on the radio show. Her elderly aunt, she would tell her over and over again, no, that's not real. And she continued to call back and pay the money. She said, but no, they said I had to call hundreds of dollars. And she
that is extortion.
It just breaks my heart.
It breaks my heart.
Right. So, I don't like telemarketing, and a lot of telemarketers are scammers. And it kind of crosses over. I got a pop-up. I don't know how it happened. You know, I just got the pop-up one day. And I said, you know, I've got these robots, and I work on phone systems. I'm going to call this number back 100 times on 20 simultaneous channels.
That's the part that sounds illegal.
Doesn't it? It does, right?
Now, anything wrong with
no,
it.
No, right.
You entirely, Leo. That sounds like complete.
So it really does, right? Now, these scammers are clearly engaging in illegal activity themselves.
Yeah. And they're not in the U.S.
They're offshore, right?
So they're probably not protected by U.S.
They're
law.
Probably not, right? Yeah. And so, right, you know, it's a very vague telecom law. I've been on just the edge of telecom law. Telecom law is very complicated, right?
The only reason I say it might be illegal is I remember, I wrote a robo-dialer back in the 80s, I think.
Okay.
And I remember there were limits on how many times you could redial a number, things like that.
Okay.
Like you could only call a number like 8 times before it was illegal. Now that was a long time
ago. Oh, wow.
Something like that.
Yeah, okay.
So I'm wondering, but so far you haven't found any rule against it. Have you been doing this?
I have mostly as an experiment because it's like whack-a-mole, right? There's only so much.
But what you'd like to do is unleash the hounds.
I really would. I can flood those. If you get a pop-up with that number, I can hit that number so hard on so many channels that no other calls get through.
So this is just telephonic.
Wait a minute.
DDoS.
He's going to DDoS them.
Yeah. But with a telephone.
Yeah. I can do it.
And fake bots.
Right?
That's
right.
Definitely illegal.
/ awesome.
So can we do it?
We can do it. Yeah, we can do it. And I've done it. I've taken numbers out of service. Now, some call centers
have many, many lines.
Some call centers have a few agents, but a lot of lines.
Yeah.
And in that case, I'm consuming their 800, their toll-free service. I'm congesting their internet pipes. I'm doing all
you
kinds of...
You might even be costing them money because 800...
Oh, no, you must be.
I am costing them money because they're paying They're paying for those incoming calls, right? Some call centers only have a couple people, right? Many of these call centers will have to cycle the numbers quickly.
Salmon's done.
Okay.
That's all right.
Let's eat.
Keep talking.
Okay.
It's just going to sit there. They're fine, but you see it's ready.
I'm
it looks
curious
delicious.
How big is the scamming network out there that's abusing these people, telling them they have viruses and they need to call in and pay money. And how big is that industry? Because I've never seen it myself in the wild.
It's funny because I'm starting to learn. In much the same way I was very naive about inbound telemarketing and how prevalent it was, I hadn't realized there were so many campaigns, so many scammers that rely on inbound calls. Right? And there are a lot of them, and there are thousands and thousands of these numbers that pop all the
Microsoft
time.
Will never do this. This isn't Microsoft
correct.
Popping up these
that's
warnings.
Correct. Right.
I've had an inbound, you know, people call me saying I'm calling from Windows.
Right.
But this is the new
I'm
scam.
Calling from Windows?
Yeah, they say I'm calling from Windows.
Like, okay, I can call like, people who run Windows.
You haven't received any of those
I don't
yet?
Answer any number on my cell phone. I can't. I don't know.
Yeah, yeah.
Because I've been writing on the
internet. So this
for
is pretty
years.
Prevalent. And,
okay.
and they're mostly scamming older people, less
right,
sophisticated
right.
people. So, but now the pop-up's probably even more effective because that gets the people to call them.
It does. And if they can inject these on malicious ads or domains that are missed just typo domains and things like that, then they can just, you know, worldwide they can get people calling in. So.
Wow. So have you, are we going to start doing this now?
Well, I'm working on some robots designed for this. The robots that I use today for telemarketing work well. Once they realize that they're being attacked, their only choice is to disconnect the number, right?
Wow.
They know the recourse. They can't put a wall in front of
it. I'm trying not to use it. It gives me all these virus warnings, but it's hard not to use your computer.
So this is an app call.
Anyway, do you want to help me with these virus warnings? Like, can you do that? You want to help?
Yes.
Okay, I should have grabbed a pen earlier.
And you're not live, right?
This is automated. My doctor told me to write this stuff down, so my memory is really bad. But I have a pen now, and I'm ready to listen. So start over. I got a pen. Okay, that pen
And may I know
work.
That you're calling from this?
I've been trying to write on it
right
with, while we're on the phone. So hang on. Here's a Sharpie. This one works. Okay, go ahead. Keep talking.
You're calling from which state?
Oh, that's a problem.
Mm-hmm.
You can't understand what he's saying.
You're calling from which state? I'm asking you.
The robot doesn't care. Yeah. Yeah. It's going to do its job. Yeah.
Okay, I've run out of room on my hand.
I'm asking.
I didn't have any paper, so I was writing on my hand while you were talking.
Oh, how calm the voice
I'm back at my desk now, and I've got paper, and I've got a working pen, and I think my meds are wearing off, so I can concentrate a little better. So now, go ahead. Start over. What were you saying?
Andy? Andy?
Mm-hmm.
And off he goes, right? Because mm-hmm. that's the 400th call that they've received today.
They're starting to wise up.
Right? Yes, they're starting to wise up. They don't know what to
made
do.
400?
Right? Well, no, more than that. Much more than that.
How many is much more than that? Like 4,000?
I've made thousands of calls into these call centers, right? Because some call centers can handle it, and it takes thousands of calls to crush
them. Your robot will keep trying until it gets the
Even if they recognize it's a robot and they hang up the phone,
they can't.
2 seconds later, another call's coming in, and it's tying, right? So, yeah, it's some of these numbers are knocked out of service. They have to cycle the numbers. I could really use help from your audience.
What would you like us to do? Because anything you want,
well
do.
There's a... There, when they cycle a number, there must be a publishing source of these numbers. These pop-ups will pop in. I think dynamically
they have to get back into the pop-up.
Right. So these pop-ups.
So they're going to a website probably. Or a,
if the pop-ups, if the number's hard-coded in the pop-up, then great, because the number's out of service, right? But very likely they're images or their phone numbers that are pulled dynamically from some IP address somewhere, right? And finding the source of the publishing of those numbers.
So.
I can knock them out 5 minutes later. After 5 minutes after they publish a new number, I can knock that new
number out. Would you like our audience to get a pop-up and tell you where?
That's working well,
yeah.
But because there are so many. So, yes, absolutely, report the pop-ups to me through jollyrogertelephone.com. There's some contact info on there, right? But really what I could really use some help with is some automation on this, right? I can automate the killing off of these numbers. I can pound them into the dust.
Yeah.
But I could really use, but I don't want to.
So would this be somebody with asterisk skills, or what kind of skills?
This would be more of someone on the domain side, or on the can look through the source code of the pop-up and say, here we go. This is the IP address that these numbers are coming from, right?
Okay.
So that would be the way to do
it. How can they contact you?
Well, I'm Roger at jollyrogertelephone.com, Facebook, Twitter, and then, of course, the website. It's all the contact info is on jollyrogertelephone.com. So.
Is it? This says JollyRogerTelco.com. Is that wrong?
Same thing.
Okay.
That's fine.
Okay.
Yeah, that's the Twitter.
You're doing the work.
Oh, thank
of the
you
Lord.
So much.
You're doing.
Thank
would
you
like some salmon?
I'd love some. I think it's ready.
Yeah. You want to have my portion? Because I'm really.
Yeah, he doesn't like salmon.
We're gonna
do the review of the oven in a bit. We have a review of the Chromebook Plus in a bit.
Yeah.
We're gonna make cookies. We're also going to talk to a dad who built a robotic arm for his daughter, and we talked to him before. We're going to get an update on that. But first, I want to talk about my new robot. Now, what's your son's name, the one who likes the cool stuff?
Nate.
Nate. He was the one who helped us.
Yeah.
Nate's going to love this. This is called Curry, K-U-R-I. Have you seen this yet? Alex is awesome. Curry is about knee-high. He's your first robot. So the whole idea, this is from Mayfield Robotics. They thought, we're going to make... You remember your first, I don't, I do, you probably don't, your first TV or, I remember your first
color.
You do.
Yeah, yeah.
This is what your kids, like Nate's going to say, I remember when we got our first robot, it was back in 2017, it was so cute, it looks at you, it blinks, it has some very sophisticated technology in Curry. Curry does not speak, it beeps and boops. That's intentional, it doesn't want to be intimidating, that's why it's a short, kids love Curry. When you first get Curry, it will make a map of your home. It'll wander around, patrol the house, make a full map. You can name rooms, kitchen, study, living room. You can say to Curry, hey, go check the couch in the living room, see if the dog's on it again. Curry's left eye there, that's a camera. So Curry can see and send back to your smartphone pictures of the house. In fact, if there's a loud noise, Curry will go check it out. And again, send you pictures back of the loud noise. Curry joins conversations, comes up to a crowd, can recognize you, facial recognition, can recognize your voice, will look from speaker to speaker. Now, people always say, well, can Curry vacuum? No, Curry's not a vacuum. Curry is a pal, it's a companion. And I'll give you an example. When you could have Curry wake you up in the morning, set an alarm, comes in, wakes you up, starts playing your favorite podcast, the new Screensavers. You say, Curry, follow me. And then as you go, make bacon, make coffee, wander, brush your teeth. Curry will follow you and continue to play your show for you. Curry is smart enough not to fall downstairs or run into furniture. It will map your house, but it also will then note it has radar and camera, so it will know if there's other obstacles, new obstacles, and it will patrol around it. Kids love Curry. She will learn about you. She will learn about what time you get home. This is the Curry Workshop we visited. We had so much fun in the Curry Workshop. This is actually our video, I think, of Curry. Yeah, I remember doing this. This is, she's so adorable. I really didn't appreciate Curry until I met her. Have her play a song. She can read bedtime stories to the kids. She can watch the house for you. She can even investigate loud noises, take pictures or video on command to show you what's happening. Now, if you're interested, visit HeyCurry, HeyCurry.com. If you want to buy a Curry, you can put a refundable deposit down right now of $100. They think it'll be this fall. But their hardware is done, and they're now adding features, software features, some really cool stuff. The idle mode. I talked to Adam, who's writing the idle mode. It's really cool. It's really cool. Curry, very lifelike. Your first robot. If you want to find out more, heycurry.com. $100 refundable deposit. If you decide to buy when they're available, $5.99 due at time of shipment, excluding taxes and shipping. Curry. Hey, Curry. Heycurry.com. Do you remember our visit? I got a little choked up. With Bodo Honan. He is the dad who used 3D printers and AI to create a brace to help his little daughter Lorelai regain use of her arm through help from friends and strangers on Facebook. It was a great interview. We wanted to get an update. We wanted to find out how Lorelai's doing, how he's doing. Here's our update from Bodo Honan.
Do you want to build a robotic arm like this? My arm was paralyzed, so we built this with help from people all over the world. Now you can build your own. As kids, we can do anything.
Hi guys, just wanted to give you an update. We appeared on Screensavers a month ago. What we've now done is we've documented all of the steps we've taken to build this device so that others like my daughter can build these devices for themselves. I've also documented three particular challenges that we are still working on that can also be found on the site. The challenges that we're currently working on is one, creating an electro sleeve to house the dry electrodes. Another challenge is to redevelop the software as open source. And the third challenge is to build a bridge between the electrode sleeve and a Raspberry Pi. You can find our site at ourkidscandoanything.com, and it would be great to get your support.
Bodo Honan, that's so cool, isn't it? Bodo Honan and what he's done. Now, let me just take the salmon out because we want to actually do the cookies.
Yeah, that's the part that I'm actually most excited
about. Yeah, you're not interested
this
in salmon.
This is not interesting.
But look at this. It's beautiful, right? Take the probe out. That's a little warm. That temperature sensor is really critical on all this. And I'm thinking you might actually really enjoy this. I'm just thinking. Yeah, a spatula would be good.
Are you thinking about me enjoying this?
Yeah. Why don't you eat fish?
Unlikely. I'd say vomit.
Oh, man. You know what we didn't do? We forgot. It's still coming up. To spray the a little Pam on the thing here, right? So that this skin would come up a little bit better, but it's all right. You love skin. I know you do. I could see it in your eyes, Alex. You are dying.
No, in fact, all of that seems quite unpalatable.
Oh,
it's
man.
Beautiful, I'll grant that, but
yeah.
Consumable.
No, you're
going
to like it. Yeah, see, I should have put a little Pam on the plate there, not to mention tin foil underneath to save cooking time, because I think we're going to have salmon-flavored cookies. A little later.
Oh,
on.
That's not
yeah,
good.
That would have been nice. Why don't we quickly get this pan?
You know, can you leave part of the skin on the pan
out?
Oh,
and we'll let's clean that pan. Yeah, just take that away, Jerry, because I don't want to cook cookies on the fish pan. Now come on.
All right, I'll feed you some of this.
No, you're gonna want to taste it.
I really don't.
Let's just see if it came out like I hoped. Oh yeah, look at that. Perfect.
I need a volunteer from the audience.
Perfect salmon. Who likes salmon?
She does. You
come. Liza, come on, have some salmon.
Eat this.
Mmm.
Have any bones?
Mm, no bones. It's a filet. Mmm.
Mmm. Yum.
Yeah. Good acting. Nice job.
And that was her cameo right there.
She is a great actor.
I know. That was, you know.
Yum. I like that, especially like that. The yum. All right.
Belly rub really cements the deal, I feel.
So we're going to do cookies next.
Yeah.
You should try that. Why don't you like fish?
Because I will throw up on your table and
no,
then
you
have
won't.
To redo my mic.
No, you're acting like an 8-year-old. Eat the fish. I will throw up. You want the fish? Okay, we're going to pass it around and let other people try this.
I got
fish.
Some on my finger. That's already pretty bad. So.
That's good. That's fish oil. That's good for you. Don't you know that?
We have very different nutritional agreements, I think.
All right.
So
let us.
It passed the test to the point. It was good.
As soon as we get the pan back, I'll put the cookies in, okay? Because you'll eat cookies, but wait a minute. I thought you don't do carbs.
No, I shouldn't do carbs, but I do.
Yeah, a little cookie. You have a little cookie.
I mean, everyone likes a little pie and cake here and there.
Yeah. So I was mentioning, we've talked about this a lot on our show this week in Google, that we love the Chromebook. You have a Chromebook Pixel, right?
I've used Chromebooks throughout their entire history.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
And the Pixel is Google saying, hey, if price were no object, this is how good a Chromebook could be. And I think everybody who's used a Pixel say, this is pretty good. It's fast.
Great keyboard.
Great keyboard.
One of the best touchscreens I've ever used in my life, even to this
Marvelous,
day.
Marvelous, isn't it?
And it's years old now. Fantastic
yeah.
device.
Yeah. But it's expensive. They started at, I think
$1,200.
Yeah. The one you wanted was $1,000 to $1,200. I think they did offer a low-end $800.
But who wants that?
And then the other end of Chromebooks is the $200, you know, kind of plasticky.
Kind of Etch-a-Sketch with some keys taped on.
Yeah.
That's very good.
So we've been saying for a while there should be something in the middle. I got to log in. Hold on.
His password is very short, non-complex, and uses no special characters.
Monkey123, in case
ah,
you're...
fantastic.
Yeah,
there you go.
You want to copy it for yourself.
I was going to log in, yeah.
Great
Why not?
Password. So this is a Chromebook that we've been waiting for with great interest. This is from Samsung, and this one is called the Chromebook Plus. There's going to be a Chromebook Pro in April.
And the Pro, I presume, is faster and costs more.
It costs $100 more, and it has an Intel chip. This has Exynos, Samsung's ARM chip inside.
What does the Plus cost?
This is $450. The Plus is $550.
The Pro
you can
is
get this one. The Pro is $550.
Okay.
You can get this one today. This is the Plus. So I thought, well, I'm going to get it. I might even like the ARM. Beautiful touchscreen. Really gorgeous.
Can I just give it a try?
Yeah. It's.
Oh, that's quite nice.
Yeah, let me open up. You can open. Yeah, just, yeah. There you go. You got,
like,
some,
I don't know,
got something open.
Reddit.
Up.
There we go.
It's a convertible, so you can stand it like this, and it'll rotate. Now you got your Reddit.
Here's your Reddit upside down.
Oh, it should rotate. Well, it's Maybe. Lying to me already. You know, it's worked at home just fine. You can also use it in, and this is, I think a lot of people would like it this way, especially because you have the Android store on here, right?
Interesting.
So I could put Android apps on here. Because it's from Samsung.
It has a stylus.
It has a stylus. This is very much like the S Pen.
Can I hold that?
Yeah, you want? Let me give you a drawing
program.
Oh,
yeah. Let's,
would you like a drawing program?
I would love that. I would love to get in trouble on air.
Yeah.
Drawing.
What do you draw?
I don't know yet.
Things.
Metallica logos? It's not clear.
That would be good.
All right, I'll see what I can do.
All right, let me.
What's the application that we're going to use called?
It comes with an application specifically for drawing. I'm going to pull it up.
Oh, kind of like Fresh Paint in Windows 10.
Sort of like that. Let me see if I can
If you don't know that,
it.
Try Windows 10. It's been a while.
I put Angry Birds on here as well because I
Is
wanted
that
to see
out?
Have the Android version. No, they have a new one, Angry Birds 2. And it plays quite snappily on this. It's 4 gigs of RAM, an Exynos 6-core, 2 gigahertz processor. There it is. Oh, no, this is actually a note-taking app, but you might like this, too.
Oh, sure, why not?
You probably have to take notes once in a while, right?
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
You can get college-ruled paper.
Okay.
You could put pictures in it. It takes handwriting. It will do handwriting conversion.
How does this work? How do I select? Oh, yeah, there we go.
There you
All
go.
Right.
You figured it out
Woo!
Pretty quickly,
That's
right?
That's sketchy. This actually feels quite nice.
Yeah, 12.3-inch quad HD display. It's almost 200 dots per inch. Don't you think the display is really high quality?
I have.
All metal construction, battery life. I'm getting 6 to 8 hours, depending on what I'm doing, which is fine with me. The keyboard is not backlit, which is kind of a bummer. I like
is
a backlit
Is that a price
keyboard.
Question, do you think? They just wanted to save the money on construction?
$450, but it's all aluminum.
It's surprisingly...
Two and a third pounds.
Yeah, it's not bad.
Doesn't that feel good? Very thin. Now, the negatives, it's got a keyboard as good as the Chromebook Pixel, I think. Mm. This isn't as good a trackpad, though. It's all right. It's just not great trackpad. And the speakers are small, little tinny, and most... importantly, they're on the bottom.
Okay.
So if you put this in your lap, they're going to
muffle up.
But on the desk, they're fine. This is, I think, at $450, a really good choice for a student, high school or even college student, if they want a Chromebook. And what pleases me is this isn't the only middle of the line Chromebook we're starting to see now. Dell has a $500 series of $500 Chromebooks, some with even very fast processors and more RAM. This one's limited to 4 gigabytes. Asus is also making convertibles, very, very similar to this. This is the only one with a stylus that I know of.
So here's what I'm kind of mad about, because for the longest time, the lower-end Windows laptops cost between $400 and $600, and they were always these big, bulky, disgusting things. This is $450, and it's actually relatively real small.
In fact, I wouldn't be surprised to see Samsung make a Windows 10 version of
this. Yeah, because I would definitely buy that to have a kind of a burner laptop for like going to China, for example.
Type-C on, just like the Pixel on both sides, so that's power and or data, but it's another one of those dongle hell situations. Mm-hmm. No standard USB ports. It's got a volume rocker, an on-off switch, and on this side, a headphone jack. This is kind of interesting. Micro SD card slot.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
So I've added a 128-gig micro SD card, which doesn't look like it's unified with the internal 32 gigs, but at least gives me more storage or a way to import and export stuff. But remember, a Chromebook is really about being online.
Yeah.
And so
it does one thing, which is internet.
Yeah. Storage is less important. However, the thing is, now that it does Android Store, I can get Lightroom on here. I can get a lot of heavy-duty apps.
Is that store robust? Is it really fully stocked enough to be useful?
Multi-million apps, yeah. It's
iPhone. It's a vanity number. People say
I understand.
That.
There's
a lot of
useless apps. But no, it has pretty much all the apps that you could see on the iPhone.
Okay.
So if you want to, you know, if you'd like to add photo editing, there's lots of choices there. Mm. Audio even. Video, there's lots of choices there. And Chrome is getting more and more powerful in that respect. There's a great Chrome extension called Polar, 2 R's, that is basically Lightroom in Chrome.
Okay.
So I think, at $450, is a really good buy, I think, for anybody who wants a safer system, a system that you can say, you know, use without fear of malware. Mm. You're not going to get those Windows 10 pop-ups. And even if you did, big deal. There's nothing they can do. And for a student who doesn't, you know, and you don't want to spend a lot of money, but you want something fairly robust, the nice thing for students is even if you lose this, you're using the cloud.
Right.
You just log into a new Chromebook and your stuff's there, or use one at school and one at home and your stuff's there. This is, for me, a definite buy. This is interesting because Samsung leaked this in November or early December by accidentally posting the website.
Accident, or was it actually an accident?
It was a good tease. It got me excited about it.
Yeah.
And it took them a few months to come out with it. Then we started seeing benchmarks for an app or a device called Kevin. And this is actually Kevin. You're meeting Kevin right now. And I think that they got a lot of interest going for it, and I think it was worthy. This is a very good choice.
How much better does it get for your use if the screen was detachable? So if you could actually detach it, how much more would you like the device?
Well, then it's something like the Pixel C tablet.
Or the Surface Line and so forth.
Yeah.
So I'm not very accustomed to laptops that come into two pieces.
Do you use the tablets?
I have a Surface Book somewhere around the house. I do like having the tablet functionality
at times.
I feel
like this is as good as I need it to
be. It's not too thick, because the keys get stuck to my fingers.
Well, and that's a negative. In fact, Lenovo is going to do a convertible where these retract.
I saw the video that looks really, really cool.
Unnecessary,
but awesome.
Yeah. You put it down. They are recessed enough that they're not on the surface there. They're not.
But if you pick it up to hold it, you definitely
you tend
get
to
a
grab
fistful
it.
Of quazd.
You tend to grab it.
Or wazd.
Yeah. I don't know. For me, this is, I tell you what, I've been using it in a variety of ways, including as a tablet because of Android. This is great for an Android app. You get a big 12-inch screen. And I've been very happy with it. I'm using it more and more. I love the lengthy battery life. I love the lightweight, the thinness. I would say a definite buy. If you're in the market for a Chromebook, you should absolutely, if you can afford spending a little bit more, look at these somewhat higher end Chromebooks, not just from Samsung. This is the Samsung Chromebook Plus, but also from Dell and Asus. This is a mature product now, and they're doing some really good work.
Why isn't Google making its own hardware here? Why are they only working with OEMs?
This is an interesting question, and I don't know what the answer is. This is supposedly from Samsung in conjunction with Google. Does that mean Google worked with Samsung? Is this what Samsung, this is going to be the Pixel, or are they going to still do a Pixel at Google I.O. coming
do you
up
recall
in a few months.
The old,
I don't know.
Do you recall Plays for Sure?
Yeah.
Yeah. So that whenever I hear like in conjunction with, that's what comes to mind for me. So I don't have really the best.
In conjunction with Microsoft in that
well,
case.
Well, in that case, sure. But I mean, I'd rather see Google set the precedent here, like Microsoft did with Surface and so forth.
It's not clear to me how much Google had to do with the design. I'm sure Google wanted to have a higher end Chromebook, and this certainly is it. So that's the Chromebook Plus from Samsung, and I'm going to give it a buy. I think it's a really good deal. Are we ready? Yes, we are. Let's put some cookies in, and then we can go on with the show.
What kind of cookies are these?
These you'll like these. These are gluten-free, flavorless chocolate nuggets.
That's perfect. So,
let's. You know what I'm curious about? I don't think I'm going to need the probe. I'm curious if it's going to recognize them. So,
because the camera's on the top, right? Of the inside.
It's inside and it's shooting down.
Right. All right.
And I don't think it's recognizing it. So if you do the flat refrigerator cookies, it does recognize them. In fact, early on, they had to do something to change the recipe because they were treating homemade cookies as refrigerator cookies and the recipe wasn't coming out right. So let me see. It's going to give me instructions. apparently, I only have three kinds. Let's say... It's certainly not pumpkin pie or biscuits. Let's say it's chocolate chip cookies. Now, this is where that distinction was. Store-bought or freshly made? I'm going to say store-bought. All right. Now,
are they on the
middle rack? No, I have to move it up because we did the bottom rack for the salmon. So I'm going to move this up. And I'm not screaming right now, but, man, that's hot. I'll be nursing my wounds.
That's
later.
Actually the rare self-burn you see in Twit.
Baking at 325 store-bought cookies, and in 13 minutes, you and I are going to have a delicious taste treat.
I'll go for a run
later on. Review the June oven. All right, our show. We're going to get to a little musical interlude in a moment, but first, a word from Blue Apron. Have you tried Blue Apron yet?
I tried it out. Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't cook that much though.
Pardon me?
I don't cook that much.
Well, this is the idea. They're trying to get you to cook more. Because I tell you what, when you eat out, you eat more calories, you spend more money, right? Yeah. It's not healthy. It's fun. But the problem is, at the end of the day, you had a long work day, you're tired. The last thing you want to do, plan a meal, go shop for it, and cook it. So you end up, I know where you go, Applebee's. You love, oh no, Olive Garden, you love the breadsticks. Am I right?
No.
No. So... That's where I end up.
I have taste buds and experience. So, you know.
Instead of going to the fast food or going to the restaurant, we go home. We got the Blue Apron box on the porch. Now, each Blue Apron box has three separate meals. It could be either for two or for a family of four. You pick the plan. You also pick what you get because you only get something you pick off the Blue Apron menu. And by the way, this is not a subscription. You choose when the box is going to come. It doesn't just come automatically. So you choose when it's going to come. You choose what's inside it. Always farm fresh seasonal produce from 150 local farms, fisheries, and ranchers across the United States. Seafood is sourced sustainably under standards developed in partnership with the Monterey Bay Aquarium Seafood Watch. You're going to get really the best seafood. Beef, chicken, pork from responsibly raised animals. The produce sourced from farms that practice regenerative farming. Look at that dog. He wants to eat that burger so bad. Oh,
today we
man.
Are all that dog.
Oh, man. Blue Apron delivers free to 99% of the continental United States. You only get deliveries when you want them. No weekly commitment, and you can customize every week. Let's take a look at what's on the menu. Here's the, I bet you that's what the doggy was looking at. Smoky pork burgers with roast vegetables and piquillo pepper sauce. See, you may not know what that is. I don't know what that is. But once you've cooked it, they give you a recipe card. They walk you through it. They've even got videos on the website, so you totally know how to do it. Chicken yakiniku with sesame, marinated carrots, and garlic rice. They always have vegetarian recipes, too, like ditali pasta and yellow tomato sauce with saffron and fennel orange salad. Ooh. Mm. Falafel. I love falafel. Falafel pitas.
This is not fair to do when I'm actually very, very hungry.
Well, you can have some salmon.
Pass.
Actually, it works great with the June oven. I use it all the time with our Blue Apron box. You're going to love Blue Apron. I want you to try it with three meals free with your first purchase and free shipping. Go to blueapron.com/NSS. Get the family plan if you've got kids. Blue Apron families cook together three times more often, you know. And it really is a good thing, a good lesson for the kids. blueapron.com/NSS. Your first three free. with your first purchase.
Blue Apron is often mentioned as an IPO candidate for the next year and a half.
Would that be
years.
Interesting?
Yeah, I know.
You know where the model works really well? Because I thought at first, oh, this is going to cost more than a grocery store. But because they don't have a brick and mortar store and clerks, it actually costs about, grocery stores like 60% more expensive. Mm. So they really, it's an interesting model where it's in effect the store coming directly to you.
Yeah.
And I find it very interesting.
I think we're in the right demographic and area for this sort of thing.
Are we?
Yeah.
Yeah. You and me.
Yeah, you and I.
No.
No, not
you,
us.
You, maybe.
Maybe.
Well, I worry about your generation. I look at my kids. no, you're under 30. You're under 30, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
My daughter's 24. I'll be 25 next month. My son's 22. And they grew up, we cooked, but they didn't grow up learning to cook. Did you learn to cook when you were a kid?
My parents tried to teach me, yeah.
But you didn't?
I was slow learner.
So you eat out a lot, right?
Every single time I eat?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's why, that's exactly.
I cannot recall the last time I turned the stove on in my house.
That's what I worry about, right? You're missing out on a huge cultural thing. Cooking a meal for friends and eating with the friends,
it's
amazing.
I enjoy that, but we have little apartments and we don't have friends. So it's tough. It's tough in SF in 2017.
Sad, lonely, lonely person.
I couldn't quite make that up. I'm glad that I couldn't hear it.
Come over, I'll cook for you.
Okay.
Just like friends, but not.
Sometimes, Leo. Sometimes.
I kid. I'm a kidder.
Yeah.
Can't you see?
Just not a kid.
I'm not a kid. No, not even close. Our resident musician, Jason Howell, the host of TNT and All About Android, has some great apps to help you tune, learn, and play guitar. He's a master. I'm curious what he's got for you.
So, you want to be a traveling musician, or let's be honest, you just want to play some guitar and maybe have a little fun. Turns out, there are a few solid apps on Android that will help you in your pursuit of stardom. So let's cover some basic tools today. First, you're going to need to get that guitar in tune before you play. Fender actually just released Fender Tune. It's a free guitar tuning app that, in my opinion, has one of the best tuning UIs on Android at the moment. You can either pluck the on-screen strings to sound the note that you need by tapping it and then tuning to that, or you can play the string on your guitar, and Fender Tune will actually let you know when it's locked into key and ready to go. In the settings, you can also find a number of alternative tunings to get really creative with your playing. Next, how about a metronome to keep you on time? Metronome Beats doesn't just sound the standard TikTok sounds, though it has those if you like them, but it offers 10 different sound choices along with a way that you can customize your own sounds, building them from the ground up. It provides a comprehensive and easy-to-use interface for changing tempo fluidly while you're actually playing if, for example, you realize The Sweet Child of Mine really should be 5 beats per minute faster. There's also a tempo trainer that slowly increases the speed over time to get you better at playing faster. Metronome Beats cost $2.49 with a free ad-supported option as well. And finally, you'll need some music to play. That's where Ultimate Guitar Tabs and Chords comes in. For $2.99, you'll get access to more than 1 million tabs so you can follow along with all of those ambitious guitar licks yourself. Tab reading is a world all its own, but the interface of Ultimate Guitar Tabs makes it a bit easier by playing through the tab with you, giving you a guiding hand along the way, as well as showing a representation of your guitar bridge down below that illustrates where your fingers need to land and when. For $2 extra, a new feature that just rolled out called Tab Tracker actually helps log the hours that you spend on individual songs, and once you master skills from a particular song, it'll suggest other songs that utilize those skills so you can keep getting even better. Most important, of course, in all of this, have fun, and make sure and send me a ticket when you play an arena somewhere here in the Bay Area. I'm Jason Howell. You can catch me on Tech News Today, all about Android and Android App Arena, reviewing apps just like these here on Twitter.
Thank you, Jason Howell. TNT Monday through Friday, 4 p.m. Pacific,
a great
7 p.m.
show.
Eastern.
Yeah.
Yeah. For news, Tech News is great, and of course, all about Android every Tuesday, 5 p.m. Pacific.
Absolutely.
So let me check the cookies. Of course, I could just look to my left and look in the oven, but why do that when you've got a video of the cookies cooking in live, real time? Now, this is cool because I could be, you know, somewhere else in the house. I can even see how the oven's doing. This is the June oven. Now, let me give you the review on the June oven. It is expensive. And I got to say that right up front, because every time I talk about this oven, people say, well, that sounds cool. But then I say, it's $1,500.
Excuse me?
Not that cool. And it is way overpriced, I have to say. But if you're looking to replace a toaster oven, or, and this is what Stacey Higginbotham says, she loves her June oven. She says, if you were going to buy a second oven, some houses have two ovens so that you can cook turkey in one and, you know, stuffing in the other one. That's the same price. So think of this as not just a toaster oven, but a somewhat larger second oven in your house. And then maybe the price doesn't bother you so much. This panel is actually Android. The reason I know that is the second day I had my June oven, and I bought it, by the way, and the second day I had my June oven, it was in a boot loop. I had salmon ready to cook, and it was going bloop, 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 June. I went on the website, and the very nice lady there said, oh, yeah, you probably want to reset, like an Android phone. You unplug it, plug it in while pressing the front button, and it, and lo and behold, the Android recovery mode came up. And I was actually able to erase data and cache, reboot it, and it's worked fine ever since.
I have never rebooted a stove before.
I know, of course not. But this is basically a small Android device in the front here. It controls the camera. There's a camera up top. That's how I can see the cookies cooking. It controls all of the cooking process. In other words, which burners are on, whether it's broiling or baking, what temperature it is at. Notice I never set a temperature to cook these. It just said, oh, that should be 350. Everything I've cooked is pretty much that way, although you can set a temperature. You can do it like a regular oven, time temperature.
Sure.
And all of that. It's a convection oven, two fans in the back. And what that means, and I have a convection toaster oven and a convection regular oven, it cooks a little faster by circulating the air inside there. It also gets a little more crispy crust. It does a great job with chicken breasts. It really crisps them up because it bakes them to the temperature using this probe. And then it broils to get the crust just right. And the skin, it looks fantastic. You can see how it's going on the phone. You get a pleasant tone when it's done. It really is kind of a neat idea. You can cook anything you would cook in an oven, including a chicken up to about 6 pounds. You can't get six pounds.
That's big enough.
That's
a whack of chicken.
It's big enough. You couldn't cook a full, Thanksgiving turkey in there.
No, it wouldn't fit.
But the sides would fit very nicely. You can cook a 12-inch pizza. You can roast vegetables. It's got a pretty sophisticated interface. It knows about a lot of different kinds of things. And what June says is it's updating all the time. So when I first plugged it in, for instance, I got an update.
Sure.
And then in the background, it's updating recipes. It's adding new recipes. You can, as I said, you don't have to use the recipes, but that's really great. You say, oh, I need to cook these chicken breasts. Let me just put them in, put in the probe, press go, and it knows what to do and lets you know when it's done. It does a very good job. I hate to say it. And I really like having this user interface as a geek on my phone. Now, it's iPhone only, which is ironic given that it's an Android device. It's iPhone only. It is very expensive. That's the negative. But it does a really good job. The one thing I've noticed is it's so far with us, it's tended to undercook. You notice I picked the kind of the dry salmon, and it was still very light and flaky and moist. And so I think that mine anyway is undercooking a little bit. Stacy, who also has one, others who have one, say that it theirs is fine, so maybe a calibration issue on this. There's one other thing that's kind of wild. I'll show you when the cookies are done. It's got little, it's got a scale in it. It's got feet that measure weight, and that's how it knows more than just the picture how to cook, how long to cook something. It's the temperature probe and the scale. You can actually weigh things in this. I can go into scale mode and put something in here, and it will tell me exactly how much that weighs using the feet. So that's also part of the feedback that it has about cooking.
So I'm very curious. You mentioned before, like, cooking is a very good thing. Friends, family, come to the house, make food for everyone.
Can you smell what's cooking?
I know, but doesn't this take some of the joy out of it by making it more automated? Doesn't it take some of the handcraftedness out of cooking by doing it for you?
I don't think so.
I just put stuff in and go, boop.
By the way, cooking is nearly finished. On my Apple Watch, it says cooking is nearly finished. So it gives you a little heads up that in about 30 seconds or a minute, we're going to be taking that out. No, because you're still cooking something and you're doing other things too. This isn't going to cook the whole meal.
Okay.
Although they do have a video. June has a great Facebook page. They have a video of cooking breakfast. You cook the bacon, toast the muffin, and fry the egg all in one pan all at once. I'm not sure I'd recommend that. I think you're still cooking. It's just that it's you don't have to monitor it as closely. Using the temperature probe, the weight sensors, the camera, you get a more accurate result. You're still cooking, trust me.
Okay. Yeah, as long as it passes your minimum threshold of actually being part of the endeavor.
Threshold. These are going to be done in 10 seconds.
Do they look done to you?
You know what? We're going to find out. Here's the recipe for cooking breakfast. You bake you bake or broil, I guess, the bacon. See, it recognized bacon.
Okay. I see.
Oh. I heard, hear that pleasant sound? That means cookies are done. Nate's very excited about this. I don't even know if they're done, to be honest. I've never done any baking in here, but they look pretty good. They look pretty good. It comes with this nonstick pan, a grill, this resettable middle grill, so you can get different heights. There's three heights inside. These are carbon fiber burners, so they heat up very quickly. Preheat time on this is much slower. I'm going to let these cool a little bit. Since we don't have Grandma's back porch, I'll just put them on top of the oven, let them cool there. So, I can't get around the price. Look at that. Cookies are ready. Isn't that cute? I can't get around the price, but I have to say I'm really impressed by this. We'll look a little bit at the scale here. I can just put this in scale mode. It should say zero because there's nothing in here. And if I put something in, it will tell me how much it is, which is kind of wild. It also has just basic settings for toasting and broiling, so you can get into there. And on the settings page, I can change the sound, set the clock. It's paired to my Wi-Fi. Sync data will actually update the app and the June servers, because I think you do share information about your cooking with the June servers so that they can update the app. It's a very fluid interface. It works very well. It's good, the software is good.
Who is this really built for?
I have no idea.
Okay.
Somebody with more money than sense.
Because, that's you.
I'm the perfect customer.
No, but I say that as a joke, but I mean, you and I would be the demo for this, but we're not that large of a group of people.
Yeah, and I'm sure that they hope to get the price down a little bit. It was kind of a crowdfunded start.
I see.
I feel like this is a really interesting device. It's, another Internet of Things device with some real promise. If they got the price down to $800, I think it would sell like hotcakes. And let's hope that they do, because I think that this is a great product.
Yeah.
And it's going to do very well. The real question is, if some big guy comes along and does something that's not as good but kind of looks the same and appeals to the same crowd, the geeks, that they may take that market away from them.
There's a startup called Serenity Kitchen that's doing a very similar sort of like robotic arm that cooks for you. You put in like food pods and it does that.
That does not hit my
so
threshold
that doesn't
of cooking.
Count, but
robotic arms, you got to put it in with your own human
AI
arms.
Is fine. Robotic arms are verboten.
Let's let these cookies cool off just a little bit. And once they're cooled, we're going to...
Are they cooked?
You can... I hope they're cooked. The June said they were cooked.
If we die...
No, you can't die from cookies. Can you die from cookies? I don't think you can.
Is there a doctor in the house?
Our show today brought to you... Anyway, I love the June oven. If you can get over the cost or you need a second oven in your house, I highly recommend it. I was surprised. I was ready to, as I told you before the show, I saved all the packing material. I knew I was going to send this back.
Right, but then it kind of stole your heart.
It stole my heart. Oh. It stole my heart. With its little chimes and its delicious
It's a four-button
cookies.
Interface.
Our four-button interface. That's good. That's simple.
Enough.
Our show today brought to you by Rocket Mortgage. You asked that question, who would buy this June oven? The same people that want to get a home loan, but they don't want to go in to see a banker. They don't want to bring boxes of paperwork. They just want to do the whole thing online, right? That's probably you. The next time you buy a home, the next time you refi a home, go to the very best mortgage lender in the country, Quicken Loans, because they've invented a loan product that's just up our alley. It's instant, fast, trustworthy, transparent, and it's completely online. I'm talking about Rocket Mortgage from Quicken Loans. They've reinvented the mortgage process to put the power back in your hands. You could actually do this at an open house. Let's say you're going around. I like to do this every Sunday. You go look at open houses.
Sure.
You say, hey, we should buy this house, honey. You fire up your phone. You go to quickenloans.com/NSS. You can, give them everything they need, checks, statements, pay stubs, touch of a button. And then it will show you can adjust the rate, you can adjust the term, get just how you like it, press go, and within minutes you'll be approved for a loan that's customized to your exact financial situation. And it comes from Quicken Loans, one of the best mortgage lenders in the country. I'd say the best. If you look at all those J.D. Power Customer Satisfaction Awards on their website, you'll see that year after year, they've won awards for primary mortgage origination and mortgage servicing, highest customer satisfaction in the U.S. Quicken Loans, Rocket Mortgage, entirely online. Skip the bank, skip the waiting. QuickenLoans.com/NSS. And now here comes the legalese, equal housing lender, licensed in all 50 states, NMLS, consumeraccess.org, number 3030. Go to QuickenLoans.com/NSS for Rocket Mortgage. They smell good. Should we?
They do actually smell very, very good.
Do you think it's too early to try?
No, I think you should definitely eat one.
Let me wipe the salmon off the spatula.
Oh, gosh.
Oh, we got a fresh...
This is the downside of doing it live.
We got tongs.
Ah, fancy.
I don't know. I don't think this is going to work.
All right.
Aye. Here, let me just use my hand.
All right, Chief.
It's not that hot. There you go. You don't mind my fingers. I washed my hands yesterday. It's good. It's good. I clean them regularly. I'll give you one, Mr. Alex. No, that's right. Hot. You can't. Oh, that's disgusting. You can't do that. Here, let's put it on the Rocket Mortgage ad.
Okay.
There you go.
It's kind of some native advertising for them.
Yeah,
all
that's
right.
Good.
Thank you, sir.
There you go. All see right. If you like that cookie. Meanwhile, while we're tasting cookies, let's find out what Facebook knows about you. Megan Maroney at...
Is it hot?
Well, at least we know the oven works. Megan Maroney has a quick look at stalkscan.com.
I don't mean to alarm you or anything, but it appears that no matter what country you live in, more and more we are headed into a surveillance state. And yet, we still persist in uploading our every move and puppy video on Facebook. Why? Well, the endorphins, of course. It's what experts call the privacy paradox. We choose the immediate joy of sharing to the long-term possibility of a nefarious person using our personal information to exploit us in some way. And that is what one ethical hacker in Belgium is trying to warn us about by creating StalkScan, a tool that harnesses all of the publicly available information that you have given Facebook and lets you see what you are revealing to the world. Inti Dukulakare, the creator of the tool, is quick to point out that it does not violate Facebook's privacy settings. This is simply information that you have chosen to make public on Facebook, you and me, or information that was public by default and that you did not make private. Before we take a look at how this works, you have to promise me that you will use it to find out what Facebook knows about you and to clean up your privacy act. Promise? Good. Here's how it works. First of all, make sure you have a friend check your profile to see what information is available to the public. Otherwise, if you check your own profile, you will see what is available only to you. So you have to be logged in to Facebook to see this. So I am logged in to Anthony's Facebook account, but I'm using my public profile to see what I'm revealing to the world. Okay, so here's my profile. It's loaded. I can see all of the pictures I've ever posted publicly. All of my posts, all of my groups, all of my future events, all of my past events. It will show all the bars where I've ever checked in. Ooh, Barber Sellers, they make good wine. Also, I can see all the pictures that I've liked and commented on. I can see all of my friends. I can see all of my classmates. If I've ever been tagged in a photo with someone else who's single, I can click on single and then look at pictures. If you're looking to find a single person that hangs out with me, there's Burke. He doesn't always wear that eye patch. So you can see how you could begin to create a sort of dossier, if you will, about me or anyone else. And all of this information is public. As a public service to my coworkers, I let them know some of the things that I know about them by using StalkScan. It wasn't creepy at all.
So, you ever been pulled over?
Yeah.
Like in 2003 in Lewiston, Maine?
Oh, that photo.
Yes. So, Josh, I noticed in 2011, you liked a photo of someone's breakfast and it was pancakes with sausage, and so like I thought you were vegan.
Hey, Burke. Nice tattoo.
How about Count of Monte Cristo? Pretty good book, huh?
How did you know I even read that book?
So, that's my privacy tip for you. One way to avoid all this information being on the internet is to totally delete your Facebook account, but who wants to do that? You'd miss all the puppy videos. I'm Megan Maroney. I host Tech News Today every day at 4 p.m. Pacific and iOS Today every Monday at 1 p.m. Pacific.
For real, though, I do like Tech News Today. That's a very good show.
Thank you.
Especially
and
when
Megan
I'm on.
Thanks you. Especially what?
When I'm on, it's even better than usual.
Oh, yeah, you're on it a lot.
No, not anymore, but sometimes.
Alex Wilhelm, He's now editor-in-chief of a brand new spin-off from TechCrunch called Crunchbase.
That's almost right.
What did I miss?
A new publication at Crunchbase, which is a spin-off from AOL. I told you I'd skip the corporate stuff.
So, when can we see this new Crunchbase?
If you promise not to tell anyone on the internet,
please.
Probably in about 2 weeks.
Good.
Yeah.
Will it be Crunchbase.com?
It'll be Crunchbase News.
.com.
It should be Crunchbase.news with you.
Oh, I like that.
Yes.
One of them fancy new TLDs.
But again, don't tell anyone. We'll have to see.
How do you like the cookies?
I think they could use some gluten.
I think you're right.
So if you're watching at home, this is what a gluten-free cookie looks like. Mm. I can't remember the angle here.
It might be
a
little
disgusting.
Undercooked. I don't know. It's hard to tell. It depends what you like. Do you like the soft inside? Because it's crunchy on the outside and soft on the inside, which I think a lot of people like.
Mm. Yeah, this just doesn't taste like anything.
It's gonna have any gluten.
It's chocolatey, kind of.
It's good.
I mean, my worst enemy maybe for lunch, but otherwise.
Anyway, it's time for the mailbag. You ready?
I am, indeed. This is the best part of the show.
Mm-hmm. Fire away, mailbag.
Mail assault.
Hello. Oh, wait a minute. There's something in here. I mean, I gotta look at this.
What is the prank?
Yeah. Let's pick a story. Any? Yeah, that doesn't. They're both the same, doesn't matter. And then let me open this up. It says, this is from Tristan and Cole. This is, do you remember, I don't know.
The last time I was on.
Was this the last time you were on?
Yeah, we talked to these guys.
They did the handkerchiefs, right?
Yeah, we thought they were super cool.
So after they were on our show, these were just a couple, like high school kids who were selling handmade, they were doing the sewing themselves, really cool handkerchiefs. They wanted to bring back handkerchiefs. There they are. And they have great patterns on them. And they immediately sold out after they were on the show.
Are you serious?
Immediately.
You loved them when we met them. You were just raving.
I wanted one. I forgot. It looks like I may have.
Sold out. That's so much fun.
I may have a little something for you.
Ooh. Now I'm feeling very special.
Yeah. And thank you. It says made just for you right on the back. And I want
to
thank Tristan and Cole. Are they back in business? Do they have more? Good. So they're sewing as fast as they're little. Oh, this is the one I wanted. This is Peppers. Look at that. Oh, isn't that nice? That's a handkerchief. And on this side, see, it's soft.
You've already soiled it.
No, I didn't. That was okay. A fake. So isn't that nice? What's yours?
I don't know. Let's find out. Ooh,
Thank you, guys. What's it a map of? Your new home.
A whole bunch of stuff. Actually,
this is where
Wall
we're gonna
Street,
send
Las
you.
Vegas Boulevard. Oh, my gosh. Wall Street. It's all right here.
Oh, it's just like all together. Oh, nice.
And I will not blow my nose in it.
Alex is America.
Indeed.
Yeah.
Oh, this is, now I need a jack to put it in.
We can work on that. All right. I have question number one. Oh, I love this one. And it's kind of germane, and I'll tell you why. I'm hoping you can help me with a recent flurry of pages that appeared on my printer last week.
Okay.
Over a few days, I've received spoof pages printed, usually in the middle of the night, that reference stack in overflowing.
Stack in overflowing.
Stack in overflowing. Do you have any idea how to, there it is. Do you have any idea how to stop these? Am I to worry that my computer or printer has been hacked? The printer pages talk about closing port 9200. Is this something I need to do? If so, how? Thank you.
I don't know the answer to this question, but I do absolutely love the art they did there.
So this is a high school kid.
Oh, that's
Stacking Overflowin's his handle. We actually were in touch with him. We were trying to get him on the show, and then he went radio silence, and I think he's probably decided that it's risky. We talked about this on Security Now. Turns out many printers, in fact, in a second we can show you a table of very big-name printers, are susceptible to this because they're designed to print from the internet. So there's a number of ways printer malware can get to your printer, and that's what's happened. These are the printers, including big names like HP, LaserJets, Brother, Lexmark,
big.
Dell, Kyocera, Samsung, Konica, Oki. So these are vulnerable to a variety of attacks, but this one in particular is port, and you got the port wrong, by the way, 9100, which is open for internet printing. And we talked about this with Steve Gibson, and I'll tell you what we're going to do. There's a wiki. Of printer vulnerability wiki, believe it or not, that describes a variety of attacks that can be executed over the internet to your printer, including denial of service, privilege escalation, which allows people to hack the printer, and here's the port 9100 printer. Stackin' Overflowin' is just a kid who read this and said, I think I could do this. And look, Shodan says there are many thousands of printers in the United States alone that are vulnerable to this attack.
So to make sure I understand, because port 9100 is open, because the printer can talk to the internet, Stack Overflow is going to printers and just printing things out, telling people to close this port.
He's actually kind of benign. He's not doing anything bad. He's just saying, you know, I can print to your printer from the network. You might want to close this
Did
port.
Did you see the prank that happened?
No.
I thought we talked about this. Oh, my. So there was a guy on the internet, and his neighbor got a new printer that was unsecured as well. And so he printed out a page that said, "Hi, I'm your printer. I'm sentient now. Run." and the store, no, that's funny, but not the end of it. Then the next day, the printer is out by the trash and takes a picture and goes, "What's this?" And then goes, collects the new printer, brings it into his house, and goes, "Free printer." So that is the less ethical side of this.
So the moral of the story, if I understand it correctly, is if your printer comes to life, keep it.
Close. The moral is, you still have a printer?
Yeah, a lot of people do. Anyway, great question. I'm actually glad to get this because I didn't know how many people had this happen to them.
Yeah.
We talked about it on Security Now, and there's an actual person that's happened to, Tom.
Well, speaking of people that actually own something, this is a Mac Pro owner. And
I gave mine to Nathan.
I was on that show.
Yeah.
All right, so I recently ran a scan of my Mac Pro using Sophos, and it showed an alert for, quote, install core, and Sophos was unable to remove it. Is this something that I should be concerned about, Bill? And all this time I thought Macs couldn't get viruses. You know, who would have thought?
Well, it's not a virus. It's a PUP.
It's a PUP, which is a?
Which is a really bad acronym.
For potentially unwanted program, I think.
Yeah, that's very good. You have a good memory. Potentially unwanted program. They don't want to call it a virus because you installed it for... No.
Oh.
Because you probably installed it unknowingly when you went to a site and there were a lot of boxes with check marks and you just said, okay. A lot of times when you download shareware, for instance, this stuff gets installed, Windows and Macs. And the problem with any computer system is... If the owner of the system says, yeah, I want to install this program.
Permission has been granted.
Yeah. You've granted permission. No antivirus is going to stop you. Nothing's going to stop you.
Yeah.
Even the Mac isn't going to stop you. It might warn you, but it's not going to stop you.
There are two answers to this particular problem with install core. One is to upgrade to El Capitan, which should take care of it according to our notes. And then the other one is very long and convoluted, and I don't fully understand it. So I'm going to vote and tell Bill to get to El Capitan, and if it doesn't solve it, right back in, and we'll take care of him.
Well,
that should solve the issue.
You can also Google remove install core, and it will tell you the steps. You have to go find it. It's easy to do, but you just have to go find it in various folders and delete it. This isn't malware in the sense that it, there you go, it's adware. It is not the sense that it takes over your machine, does bad things, encrypts your files, extorts money from you. It merely makes it so you're going to change your search engine, you're going to get pop-ups or spontaneous advertising when you surf the net. You don't want that.
No. Privacy is important. You should keep
notes. Call it malware, but it's a pup.
It's a pup.
It's a pup. Pretty much the Mac attacks are mostly pups, but just this week we saw some malware emerge on the Mac. We've seen the first ransomware on the Mac. Mm-hmm. The Mac has never really been immune, but what Apple does, I have to give them, you mentioned, for instance, the new version of the operating system would take care of this.
Yes.
Apple has some tools that run in the background that will block known malicious software, that will remove known malicious software without your even knowing, and they push updates to that fairly frequently. So Apple is doing some clever things behind the scenes that nobody even knows to remove malware. And that's why I don't think we see widespread malware on the Macintosh.
No, we don't. But even now with Windows 10, I really do feel like a machine out of the box is pretty darn safe. So now when I fire up a new OS 10 or a new Windows 10 machine, I'm not racing to install Avast or McAfee or whatever it is.
I actually
feel pretty good.
In fact, that is dramatically different
than it was 5, 7, 12 years ago.
I would install antiviruses because we've already seen a couple of examples of antiviruses opening up flaws.
Yes.
So
by presenting new vectors
make you
for
less,
hacking.
Yeah, it can make you less secure. On the other hand, things like that June oven, things that are on the internet, those things are going to be the next attack vector because they are, just like Windows, just like Mac, on the internet, but often don't have the updates, don't have the protection.
We've already seen a lot
of that. What else are you cooking? Cookies? More cookies?
Oh, my.
They're ready. Cookies are done.
I still have a cookie right here. If anyone wants the gluten-free
There's not a huge demand for gluten-free cookies among the
Although if we were in San Francisco, demand would be off the charts.
That's right.
Yeah.
So that's the, I think that's the next attack vector. We're going to watch, and this is going to be the year the Internet of Things starts to really become, I think, more of a problem. We talk a lot about it on security now.
But we barely got the benefits. Now we're already to the problem.
I know.
I feel relatively cheated in this entire exchange.
Well, something like the June oven, I feel pretty good. Stuff that is made, I don't want to say made in America, but stuff that's made by responsible American companies instead of just kind of anonymous Chinese companies tend to get updates, firmware updates. The people who make them tend to pay more attention to them. The real problem has been with cameras that are just cranked out of factories in China with no oversight and no ownership, really. I mean, they're rebranded, they're sold by other companies, so the firmware never gets updated.
Right.
Those are things, and so far that's what we've seen. Those are really the biggest threat.
Well, everyone knows Android is completely unhackable, so there's nothing to worry about.
Yeah, right. Well, it is an Android oven, isn't it? Yeah. I think I'm... You know what?
If you hack Leo's oven,
what would you do? Wait
lunch.
A minute. If you could get in my oven, would you burn my cookies every time? What would you do?
I would end every cooking session 2 minutes before it's supposed to be done, so everything you ate was slightly gross.
That's pretty bad. Maybe even risking salmonella. And then would you post videos of my undercooked food on the internet?
It would be like Leo reacts, like PewDiePie. There will be no season two.
That is the brand new editor-in-chief of the Crunchbase at crunchbase.news.
Eventually, crunch.com for now.
Soon.
Yes.
Congratulations on
Thank
the
you,
new
sir.
Job. And come back anytime. I love having you on this show and Tech News Today and Twit. I think you're up for Twit pretty soon.
Yeah, right? I think I'll be on Twit in March.
Good.
Yeah.
Can't wait.
All right.
Nice to see you.
Thank you for having me.
And your lovely friend, Liza. Hi, Liza. Yeah. A great actress, by the way.
Fantastic.
Our survey ends at the end of the month, so you only have about, what is that?
Two more weeks?
Not even that long, yeah, about 10 more days to get out there and take the survey. We really appreciate it if you do. We've made it short. It's just a couple of minutes. Basically, you're giving us information so that when people say, I want to buy an ad, who's watching your shows, we can give them not your name. Believe me, we anonymize it. We don't care about your name or your email address, but say, you know, we have a certain number of men, certain number of women, this kind of education level, that kind of thing.
So this is an easy way for them to help you guys.
It helps us a lot in selling advertising. And the reason we do it this way, we don't want to spy on you. So a lot of companies will put bugs on their website and they'll gather information about you and find out about you that way. We don't do that. We just do this survey once a year. So it really helps us if you get a chance. twit.tv/survey. We do this show every Saturday afternoon, 3 p.m. Pacific, 6 p.m. Eastern Time, 2300 UTC. If you want to come by, we'll either put a chair out for you, just email tickets at twit.tv. Bring the whole family. Sometimes there's cookies. You can also watch us on the stream. We're everywhere, twit.tv/live, live.twit.tv. We even have a YouTube live stream, youtube.com/twit, twitch.tv/twit. We're on Twitch. We're on Ustream. But if you can't watch live, you can't be in the chat room during the show, don't worry, we got on-demand audio and video of everything we do. In this case, it's at twit.tv/NSS. Thanks for being here, and we'll see you next time. No more cooking, though, on the new Screensavers. Bye-bye. Cooking!